Okay, so let's see what we got, where we left off. Tax collector. Four for five, every ally turn on turn end gain one crown. One crown. Okay, so it plays five for five initially because you're gaining, when you play the card, you get one crown and it's already a five for five that has future benefit. That's very good. That's a very good card then. It's a five for five. That's an engine card. It's kind of like, it's almost like priest. Obviously, it's easy to kill than priest, but it's kind of like priest. It's a five for five, although priest is actually a four for five initially. So it's actually, it's in a way better than priest and in a way worse than priest. It's kind of better and worse than priest. It plays five for five right off the bat, and it's an engine. I think it's a very good card. I would definitely run this in decks that rely on crowns. Decks that want crowns, I think this is a pretty good engine to have. It's a really good card. Yeah, it seems like a very strong card. This card seems pretty strong. Especially in decks that want crowns, and especially in like engine overload decks, I think this card would be very good. In like an engine overload deck where you that relies on crowns, this card is probably auto include. Pretty good card, I think. Very good card. I expect to see this card be played a lot. Also, thank you for the follow. Static114, welcome to Komodo Army. I expect this card to see a lot of play. Seems very strong. Pugo Boombreaker, dual monster card. Okay, this is a very interesting card. I like this card a lot. Deploy damage a random ally enemy unit. No, sorry, a random allied unit by three. If there are no allies, damage salt by five instead. So, if you play it on a naked board, it's a five for seven, which isn't great. You obviously want to control, because it's going to be a random allied unit. So you obviously want to play this early in the round. You don't want to just be playing this on like an open board state. Right? This card might be worth it to copy. What, this card? Yeah. Oh, yeah, maybe. Yeah, that card could be worth it to copy with thingy. Maybe. But this card is. All right, we'll see it later, right? Oh yeah, we'll see it a bit. Okay. Right, we'll get to that in a minute. Okay. So back to this card. So you obviously want to be using this card in maybe a Ruckus. Okay, so the thing is, this card, although it's a 10 for 7 in a Ruckus Queen, which is really good, by the way, a 10 for 7 is always very good. The problem with a Ruckus Queen is you're fighting for so much. There are so many good cards in Ruckus Queen. Although it's a 7 provision card, so you could maybe squeeze into a Ruckus Queen deck. In a Ruckus Queen, this is just a 10 for 7, which is really good. A 10 for 7 is insane. It's a nice, easy, like proactive type of card. It's a very easy 10 for 7 in Ruckus Queen. The only thing is the Ruckus Queen's provisions are very tight. There's some very good cards are fighting for slots in Ruckus Queen. Outside of a Ruckus Queen, you could play this. This is also has a very big body, so it's very good for dominance, right? You could play this in like a Gernakura deck because you can eat your Gernakura fruit. You could eat maybe a Foglet, so you can trigger the Death Wish of a Foglet. You can trigger the Death Wish of a Harpy. You can trigger Death Wish of a Fog of just an ancient Foglet or normal Foglet, one of the two. So this card is really good in monsters. I don't know how good it's going to be in Syndicate, but in monsters, this card is nuts. In monsters, this card is really good, especially in like dominance decks. I'm not sure in a Ruckus Queen, although it's very good in a Ruckus Queen. I don't know if people run this in a Ruckus Queen because a Ruckus Queen has very tight slots. But I would say this card is auto include in like a dominance deck, a Gernakura woodland deck that has dominance. This card is auto include. Not just that, but it's got a high base strength, which means it's also good food for Ozreal, which is great. So you don't have to waste like over provision. The thing with Ozreal is. You have to play things like Spear Tip, and those cards are very overcosted. Whereas this one isn't overcosted. It's a high base body strength that's not overcosted. It's actually undercosted. So it's really good, especially for Ozreal. This is insane in a dominance deck. I don't know if this will be enough to bring dominance back to like, you know, the light of day, but this is gonna help dominance decks out quite a bit, I think. This is a very good card in dominance. I would play this at Ozreal even. Yeah, definitely. In most monster decks, you'd run this. I'm just not 100% sure if you'd run this in a Ruckus Queen. I'm not 100% sure. Maybe. If you've got somewhere to squeeze this in, possibly. It's only a 7 provision card, so it's basically like a Griffin, almost provision-wise. This is literally just a better Griffin. This is honestly just a way better Griffin. This is quite literally just a better Griffin. But you can't, obviously the one downside of this, you can't use it like in the middle of a round because the one downside is if you play this in the middle of the round, you have to rely on RNG and that could go bad for you. So it's a little bit less flexible than Griffin, but overall just much better than Griffin. And you also can only one copy of it. Okay, so next card, Wheel of Fortune. Damage an enemy unit by a random amount between 1 and 10. 5. Oh, boy. Okay. Well, I mean, it's a 5 provision card. On average, it's playing for 5. It's actually playing less than 5 on average. Because, okay, this actually doesn't play for 5 on average, right? This actually doesn't play 5 on average. Because you have to have, assuming that every single time you're going to target a 10-point card, then it's playing 5 on average. But there's not always going to be a 10-point card. There are going to be scenarios where you put this on a 6-point card, and it's going to do 10 damage. You're going to overshoot the damage, which means the average goes down. So it's actually on average going to be more of like a 3.5 or 4-point card, kind of. So it's actually not even a 5 average card. It's actually playing below 5 on average. Because it's going to overshoot very often. If you had a 5 strength card, you know, it's all enroll between 5, 6, and 10 to kill. Yeah, you're going to overshoot sometimes, which means all the times you're going to overshoot, it's going to bring the average of this card down. So actually, it's not even a 5 for 5. It's actually just like a 3.5 or 4 for 5, I think. You can butcher engines, yeah. So the nice thing is, it's removal, right? You could use this as like a cheap removal card, kind of. Because there's a very good chance that you'll kill like a low engine, like a 3-point engine card if you play this card. There's a very good chance. If you play this card, there's a 7 out of 10, you'll kill the engine card. If your opponent plays like an obelisk and you play this card, there's like a 7 out of 10, you'll kill the obelisk. So it's, I guess, good at killing, but it's a special card. It's not even that great. There's more efficient removal cards than this. I don't know. I don't expect to see this card being played that much. It's not that bad of a card, but it's really inconsistent. And it actually plays below provisions on average. On average, this card's actually going to play below its provision. It's going to play for 3.5 or 3.5 to 4 points on average, I think. If it's a crime, okay, that's true. If it's a crime, it's gonna. If it's a crime card, that also true. I didn't take that into account. If you consider crimes, which probably actually is a crime, it's gonna make a lot of cards a lot better. It makes things like this better. It makes your leader ability better if you're playing Cleaver. So with crime tag, maybe I think yeah. If with the crime tag, I should throw this in the deck just for the crime tag. It's quite annoying though. I guess with crime tag, this card is worth running because you could get like at least 2 or 3 or 4 value just from the crime tag alone, depending on the deck. But on average, this card's going to play by itself. I'd say it's going to play on average for like, let's say 3.75 value, I would say. With the crime tag, obviously, I think this will probably play on average for about 6 value, probably, depending on how you built your deck. But overall, I don't really like the design of this card. It's kind of just, you know, high roll card. I don't really like it. But yeah, we'll see. Don't really like the design of this. But sure. Let's move on. Cyprian Wiley, aka Horson Jr. Damage an enemy unit by 7. Then gain crowns equal to the excess damage dealt. Alright, it's a leader ability. Oh boy. Okay. It's comparable to Adder, but with a bit more flexibility. Whereas Adder, if you use her leader ability to kill like a 4-point card, you're overshooting. Whereas this card, at least you're getting crowns then. So it's comparable to Adder. The thing with Adder's leader ability, right, is Adder's basically a 16-point leader when you consider Hubert, kind of. She's kind of a 16-point leader with Hubert. So the thing with this guy's lead ability is, the nice thing is you can get also double value with this guy's lead ability. When you take bounties, so I think this leader ability, I think this will be best used in like a mid-rangey, like bounty deck. A deck with witch hunters, a bounty type of deck, I think this leader ability is pretty good. Because you can very easily activate or kill a bounty card with this. This is just an easy way to kill a bounty card. And I think it's good in like a mid-range deck. I think if anyone wants to run like a mid-range deck, you'll probably run this as a leader. And you'll probably run this with like witch hunters and, you know, other witch hunter type cards. I'll probably see this played in a deck with maybe this guy. You throw in some witch hunters. You throw in Graydon, some other bounty type of cards. And I think you got yourself like a little bit of a mid-range removal deck, which is probably actually will be quite decent, actually. So I definitely expect to see this being played. This leader ability doesn't seem too bad. It has synergy, and I think this will be like the kind of like a mid-rangey type of leader, honestly. After seeing Horsen's ability, I hope Adder gets a buff. Yeah, Adder's. I mean, it's just Northern Realms in general. Hansel's like the only really playable lead in Northern Realms right now, but we'll see. But I think this is a decent ability. It supports like a mid-range type of deck, a mid-range removal, Witch Hunter type of bounty deck. I think this card is pretty good in. So I definitely expect to see this being played a bit. Seems quite decent, actually. 16 provisions also not bad. Not bad for that leader ability. But yeah, so let's do the math. So let's think about it, right? If you play this to kill a seven that has bounty, a seven base strength card that has a bounty, and you kill that card, then this leader ability basically plays for 14 points, which isn't bad. 14 points on a 16 provision card is really good. So I think that's pretty good. Well, not 16 provision card, but 16 provision leader ability. So in an ideal situation, this leader basically plays for like 14 points. If you kill a card with like a 7 point card that has a bounty on it, this basically plays for 14, which is not bad. So pretty good leader ability, I think. Okay, next we have Igor the Hook. Insanity. Okay, so for those who don't know what insanity does, it basically means if you don't have the coins to do the fee, you can still trigger the fee at the cost of its own points equal to the deficit you need to play. So if you have, let's say, 4 crowns and you activate the fee 5, you'll damage self by 1 then. Basically, that's what this means. So insanity, fee 5, spawn a base copy of a bronze allied unit and summon it to Eagle's Row. So right off the bat, that seems really weak because the fee 5 basically means minus 5 here. So it's 6 points, minus 5. It's a 1 point card that spawns a bronze copy or base copy of a bronze allied unit. So basically, that makes it a 1 for 10 plus a bronze card. So that means that bronze card that you get has to get a value of 9 points to overcome the provision cost. It's kind of like a worse Adalia to me. It seems very bad. Because that means you're gonna have to get 9 points of the bronze. I don't know how many bronzes can do 9. Maybe this can sometimes do 9. If you can do it on this and this card sticks and you get other copies of it to stick, you could do 9 points on a bronze. Then sure. This can do 9, maybe. It has to survive for 5 turns. Well, 4 turns because it gets automatically triggers on your first turn. So it has to survive for 4 turns. And then this can do it, but surviving 4 turns is a bit of a tall order. So I'm not sure about that. Overall, I think this card's quite weak. It seems to me like a worse Adalia, to be honest. You can feed 2 times and then kills himself, kind of like what is a Broccolon? I guess it's an interesting consideration then. I guess if you do it twice, you could spawn 2 of these. And then it's kind of like it's kind of like a Waters Broccolon. That's an interesting thought. That's an interesting thought. I mean, you're still playing a very, it's still gonna, you're still, bronze are still gonna have to get them, both of them are combined are gonna have to get quite a lot of points. Your bronze are gonna have to get quite a lot of points to make up for this, but it kind of seems weak though. Also, thank you for the follow, Fenriri. Welcome to Komodo Army. Thank you very much for the follow. Really appreciate it. Overall, this card seems kind of weak. I guess maybe if you want to like use it on like 2 of these and use that insanity and kill himself and play 2 of them, maybe. Overall, I'm not sure. He seems kind of weak to me, but maybe you could build a deck that can utilize this. There are some very strong bronze engines. That you could maybe use on this, but they would have to stick. And the problem with that is I think then this card could only get good value if those bronze engines are sticking. And if those bronze engines are sticking, you're probably going to win the game regardless because you might have other engines that also will stick then. So I'm not sure. I think he's kind of weak, but maybe we'll see. We'll see. Maybe he seems some play. Not 100% sure just yet. Okay, let's move on. Horsen Senior. Intimidate. Okay, so he's got the intimidate tag. In other words, every time you play a crown, a bribery, not a bribery, a crime card, he gets +1, 6 for 10. Transform adjacent unit into Cataplacky. Tribute 3. Transform adjacent units, so basically 2 of them, into Cataplackys instead. So I was discussing this yesterday in my Discord. This, in a way, is kind of a win more card, in a way, because the Cataplacky is required to play bribery cards. So here's the thing, right? Let's say you play Portal with these guys. Then you play another two other bronze cards or whatever, and you transform them into Cataplackies. That's insane. But the problem is they're probably just going to get answered. If they don't get answered, this card wins you the game on the spot. If you could get four Cataplackies on the board to stick, that's literally, I don't know how many points it is a turn. That's insane. Maybe the way to play this is you play Cataplackies, Portal, you play this guy, and you play this guy. You try overwhelm your opponent with just a bazillion Cataplackies. Maybe. Your opponent might not have answers for all of it. So you play two with Portal, you could potentially play two with this guy, maybe even more. And then another two with this guy. That's six Cataplackies. If some of them stick, that's a lot of points. Because this card damage a random enemy unit by one every time a crime card is played, and bonded, which in other words, the more copies you have, increase the damage by one, which can go up to like four or five, which is insane. Or six even. So it depends. I think overall though, I'm not 100% sure, but it seems very scary. If this card can stick and you can build a deck that can support this properly, this card could be insane, but it requires your opponent not to be able to kill stuff. So I'm not 100% sure. This might be a win more card, but I'm not 100% sure. Does Fee mean you can buy for 5 coins his ability again? Yeah, basically. You can activate Fee any amount of time. Yeah, as long as you have the coins to support, you can activate the Fee over and over and over again. So interesting card, but I'm not 100% sure. Arena Ghoul. Deploy on turn end, destroy self. Tribute to cancel deploy ability. So it's 7 for 5, but it's going to destroy itself on turn end. So it plays 5 for 5. I'm assuming you're going to want to play that tribute too. Otherwise, it just dies. Is there any way to utilize the 7 for 5 without actually having to tribute to? You wouldn't want to waste the lock on yourself. That's not worth it. Otherwise, you may as well pay the tribute too, because then the locks are overcosted anyway. You can consume it? Sure, you can consume it, but I mean, you can't just play a 0 point card just for Ozreal value. I mean, okay, I see what you mean. You play like Kairn, and then you play this card and you consume it immediately. I see what you mean. Okay, I see that. That's what you mean, right? You mean like a Kairn or a Slizzard or a Barbagazi, just instant consume this. That's not bad. It's not bad, but the thing is, isn't it just better to run like a Harpy Egg or something like that in that situation? If you're doing it like that, you may as well just play a Harpy Egg. Oh yeah, it's a Syndicate. Oh, that's also true. Also, you need a Syndicate. Right, it's not even a dual faction card, so you can't even do that anyway. So is there any way in Syndicate to get use of this without having to play the tribute too, or is it just a 5 for 5? Because right at the bat, if without ways to consume it or anything, it just looks like a 5 for 5 to me. Unless I'm missing something. Is there any way to actually like get use of this without having to use this? Because otherwise, just a 5 for 5. You can Summoning Circle and eat to the Destroyer's Arena Wyvern. I guess, but that's... You have to get Summoning Circle to stick. That's a bit of a schlep to go through just for this. And those Arena Wyverns are also kind of overcosted as well, so you kind of don't even get this value then. Yeah, it sounds pretty bad. Isn't 7 for 7 good? It's 5 for 5, not 7 for 7. I mean, it's okay. I mean, it's 5 for 5 or 7. It's, you could kind of cost it a 7 for 7. It's basically a 5 for 5. But it can very break. It can also, it's not just that, but this card forces you. It absolutely forces you to use this. You have to use this. So it's not just a 5 for 5, but it absolutely forces you to play this tribute too. You can't just be discarding cards. So the problem is it's not flexible. You are forced to use tribute too. So if you top deck this in a short round 3 and you don't have ways to get coins, it's a 0 point card. I don't know what deck this even fits in. This doesn't synergize with anything either. It doesn't really have any synergies. It plays into bounty because it's a tall base strength, so it plays into opponent's bounties. It doesn't really synergize with anything. Kind of seems a bit average. Seems a bit actually lower than average to me. I don't know. This card is kind of just, I don't know what its purpose is. I don't know what the point of this card is. I mean, I could see it in monsters, but even then, even if it's in monsters, you have better things to consume with. You could just consume Harpy Eggs and stuff. That's better than this, if you want to just try play for that. Because consuming a Harpy Egg is worth 5 points. Consuming this is worth 7 points. So, I don't even understand. Even if it was Monster Duel Faction, I don't even see it. So, yeah. Overall, kind of just meh, I think. Arena Indrega. 5 points, 5 provisions, insanity, fee 1, damage an enemy unit by 1, cooldown 1. So it's basically like a Skellige Light Longship, right? You can spend 1 point and you get to damage enemy unit by 1 every turn with cooldown 1. So it's kind of like Skellige's Light Longship. And then if you want insanity, if you don't have those coins, you can just damage self by 1. Then it's exactly a Skellige Light Longship. So it's a pretty good card then. It's basically Skellige Light Longship with a little bit of flexibility. So if anything, it's actually better than Skellige's Light Longship. It's slightly better than Skellige Light Longship because there's a bit of flexibility. So I guess it's a very good card then. It's a 5 for 5. It's a longship with zeal and no reach. Oh, that's true as well. It doesn't have zeal either. So it's much better Light Longship then. It's zeal and no reach too. Then it's a much better version of a Light Longship. That's a very good card then. Because Light Longship's already pretty much auto including every Skellige deck. So this is just very, very strong then. Wow. I mean, the thing is, okay. So the thing you got to think about, though, is there's not as much synergy supporting this card in this faction than in Skellige. Skellige can use this Bloodthirst for like things like Priests. I mean, Protectors. It can use it to line up for Bloodthirst. It can use it to line up for Primal Savageries. So I think that Light Longship still has a little bit more support within Skellige than this card will have. But I think still this card is very good. I think you would run this in like most Syndicate decks. It seems very strong. This seems like a very strong card. I would expect to see this in like most situations. Okay, this card is like this card, but even more dumb. So this card is insane, by the way. Let me explain to you why. Insanity. Fee 1, give an enemy unit bleeding for 1 turn. If insanity was used, damage by 1 instead. This is very flexible removal. You can pay those fees over and over and over and use this very, very flexible removal. This is an easy 6 for 6 removal card. Because you could just use all the charges, you can just go insanity over and over and over again and just kill whatever you want, basically. So it's kind of like a Light Longship again, but like a very OP version of a Light Longship. This is kind of like this card, but like a very overpowered version. This is very easy 6 for 6. It's not even overcosted. It's removal that's not even overcosted. Typically removal cards are overcosted. If you look at something like Skjoll is a 7 for 8. If you look at things like Regis, it's an 8 for 10. Normally, removal is overcosted, but this guy is not overcosted. This card in Woodland Pepe Love, I mean, sure, but it's not Monster Duel faction. This card seems very strong. Yeah. If you can use Insanity and give a damage instead by 1. So this card is very flexible removal. You can just use... If your opponent opens with a 4-point engine, you really want to kill it, you play this card. Proc its insanity 4 times, kill the 4-point card, and then, you know, easy 4 removal. But the big difference in hard and soft removal. But this card is still really good. I mean, this card seems very, very strong to me. It's very flexible removal. Does first use the bleeding or damage, Monkum? As far as I understand, fee 1, give an enemy unit bleeding for 1 turn. If insanity was used, damage it by 1 instead. So I guess if you're using fee 1... it's only doing bleeding, and if you're using insanity, it's doing damage instead. But I'm not sure. At least that's what I'm understanding from it. But this card seems very strong. This card seems very, very strong. It's like a Light Longship that can use all its charges in one turn. The way to look at this card is a 6-point Light Longship, I think, that can use all of its charges in one turn. Just go ham. That's pretty good, though. That seems very strong. This card seems very, very strong. I would really consider putting this in quite a lot of decks. Seems like a very, very strong card. Looks like it could fit in quite a few decks too. Seems scary strong, actually. This card seems very, very strong. I would maybe consider, I mean, if you give it cooldown, then it becomes like another Light Longship, which makes it kind of pointless because you could just run this card, but I'm not sure. I don't know how you'd balance this card, but right now, I mean, I don't know if it's broken, but it seems very strong. We'll see how that goes, I guess. Okay, let's see. Kikimore Warrior, dual monster card. Order. Destroy an allied unit, then spawn a Kikimore Warrior and summon it to the same row. So it's basically a Revenant, in a way. It's kind of like a Revenant. Dual monster faction. This is really good, Narrakis Queen. This is... only, the problem with the Narrakis Queen is you might row limit yourself. So... you destroy an allied unit. You can also use that to trigger death wishes, which is nice. And then you spawn another warrior and summon to the row. So it plays for three. In Arrakis Queen, it plays for it's a 3-point card that's 3 points. It's a 3-point engine card. It plays for three and then it's 3 points every turn, basically, in Arrakis Queen. In other monster decks, it depends what you're destroying. I mean, it's pretty good in Gunakura as well, right? Kind of. I mean, is it though? Is it good in Gunakura? I mean, then you have to reutilize it every turn. The Thrive is already getting 1 point a turn. It's, I guess, not bad in Gunakura, but I don't know. It's kind of not bad in Gunakura, I guess, because you can eat your fruit if you want to. Why is it order? I mean, I guess it's order to balance it, because otherwise it's a six. It's a 3+3-1, depending what you're eating. It basically plays for 5 or 4. I mean, I guess it's the same as, it's almost like a Revenant, I guess. It's like the monster version of Revenant, or the Syndicate version of Revenant. It seems decent, I think. This seems like a decent card. It's an engine card. I mean, I don't know if this is going to be run much in Syndicate. Maybe you eat a bunch of Zealots to play around, like, removal. But then you're playing to Lacerates and stuff anyway. You're still playing to Gimpy and Lacerates regardless. Doesn't really make a difference. I don't know. This seems like it's going to be mostly used in monster decks. I could definitely see this being played like a Arrakis Queen. The only thing about Arrakis Queen is, like I said, you might run into a row limit issue. If this card actually sticks, you might row limit yourself very quickly with this card. So I'm not even sure how good that is in a Arrakis Queen, but I mean, it does seem somewhat decent. It's not going to be run in any deck. Yeah, I mean, it's all. I mean, I think, I don't know. It might be. I don't know. It seems, it's the thing about a Arrakis Queen is row limit. If this card sticks, you're hitting row limit quite quickly. So I'm not 100% sure about that. And monster decks, I don't know. You could use it to trigger death wishes, but then it's probably going to die. I don't know. It seems kind of interesting. It seems awkward. I'm not sure. It's like a Revenant without that much support and without the removal value. I'm not sure. If you have coins and base strength on your card, can you choose whether you pay fee and insanity? Yeah, you can choose. You can always choose. You can always choose if you want to spend the coins or not. Oh, if you have coins, if you want to choose between insanity or not. I think if you have coins, I think at first you automatically choose. It takes the coins from you, if I'm not mistaken. If I'm not mistaken, it just takes the coins from you. And then if you don't have coins, then insanity triggers, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, let's move on. Payday. Damage aimed by 2, death blow gain 5 coins. Okay, so this is basically Primal Savagery, but for Syndicate. And instead of gaining a Savage Bear, well, not a Savage Bear, a Bear Abomination, you gain 5 coins. So, basically Syndicate's version of Primal Savagery, basically. Looks like, I mean, there's not much else to it then. So instead of gaining a Bear Abomination, you're getting 5 coins. So, basically Primal Savagery of Syndicate. 5 provision, basically plays for 7 points. 2 damage, plus 5, 7 points for 5 provisions. Basically Primal Savagery of Syndicate. Not much else to discuss there. Alright. There'll be a row full in like 3 turns. Yeah, that's the one problem with that. That's the biggest issue with this. Anyway, Boris. Damage an enemy unit by 3. So it plays 6 for 8 initially, because it's an 8 provision card. So it plays 6 for 8 initially, death blow, gain 3 crowns. So if you get the death blow, you gain 3 crowns, basically plays 9. That's a pretty strong card. That's good removal. 3 damage is decent removal. So the thing is, 2 removal is typically not enough removal to kill like those engines like Arbalest, you know, Revenants. It's not enough removal to kill the annoying engines. But at three damage, it can kill an engine card and play for 9 points. So I think that's actually pretty strong. Damage aim unit by 3, death blow gain 3 crowns. So it plays 9 for 8 if you get the death blow. If you don't get the death blow, it plays 6 for 8, which isn't terrible. If you kill like a 2, it still plays 8 for 8. If you kill a 1, it plays 7 for 8. If you kill a 1, you overshoot, you lose 2, but you gain. So it's still okay. So if you kill a 1, it's still playing 6 for 8. So overall, this card, I think, is pretty strong. It's good removal. It can kill, like, those annoying engines, and it plays over provision. Now, the thing with removal is, the one thing that's really, you have to keep in mind with removal, is normally removal is overcosted. If you look at most removal cards in the game, Melaine, she's an 8-point card that costs 9 provisions, although she has flexibility, so she kind of cheats it because she has an alternative use, which is pretty nice. Skjold plays 7 for 8. Regis plays 8 for 10. Most removal cards are overcosted. Whereas this one can actually get more value than the provisions and its removal, which makes it very, very strong, I think. That's pretty attractive, I think. I think it's a pretty decent card. I would expect to see this card being run in a couple of decks, especially like a Horsen deck. I would expect a card like this and this and this and this and some bounty cards. And you play Horsen. You make like a bounty type of deck with a bunch of mid-rangey cards, and you run a deck like that. I think seems decent. I can already see a deck lining up with this stuff, with these type of cards. Like I'm really starting to like theory craft it in my head. It seems quite decent. A deck like this, I could definitely see this being played. Seems pretty useful. So fee one insanity is not that insane as we thought. I mean, you spend your crowns off it, I mean, before that or whatever, or if you really want to, you spend your crowns, give other things bleeding until you have zero crowns, and you're just using like machine gun to kill everything, or you just spend your crowns before a turn earlier or something like that. He's very, very flexible, but yeah, we'll see. 3 minutes till dev stream? No, it's like a couple of hours. Still 2 more hours, I think. Novigrad duel. Look at the top 3 cards from your opponent's deck and move one. It's a Novigrad duel card, okay. Melee, look at the top. So 4-4-4. Look at the top 3 cards from your opponent's deck and move one to the top. Move one to the top. Deploy range. Look at the top 3 cards from your deck and move one to the top. So I'm seeing some synergy with Trehearn and Cantarella and Viper Witches. Which I don't like those cards. The cards this card synergizes with kind of are disgusting. The Novigrad cross faction? Yep, Novigrad dual faction. The cards that this card synergizes with kind of seem disgusting. I guess in round... No, it doesn't really make a difference because you're mulligan getting into it anyway. Viper, which is random card. Oh, is it random? Okay, never mind then. So it's not even synergizes with that. Synergizes then with Trehearn and Cantarella. Okay, Viper, which is random then. Okay, never mind. So it doesn't synergize Viper, which is, I guess it synergizes with Cantarella and Trehearn. Which is kind of meh. What else does it synergize with? Is there any other thing, any other reason you want to put something on top of their deck? I guess what's her face? What's the card's name? Isabel. But then you have to keep this card for round 3, and you don't want to be playing a 4 provision card in round 3. I don't know, it seems kind of meh to me. The cards that it synergizes with are kind of bad anyway. I mean, you get a bit of information, you get to see what they're going to top deck into, I guess, but... It's a 4 provision card, so it's a 4-4-4. It's okay, but it's like the same as every other Novigrad card. They play 4-4-4 with a little bit of annoyance. Like, infiltrators, they all, like, do the same type of thing. They're kind of annoying, they're kind of gimmicky, they play 4-4-4. Deploy range, look at the top 3 cards of your deck and move one to the top. I mean, that's... Is that even useful? I guess it's useful with Shoop. Well, Shoop random. Does Shoop take the top card of the deck or take a random card? Let me know. Viper Witcher is the top card I just checked. Oh, really? What is really strong about it is playing as information? Yeah, kind of. But when the meta settles, you kind of know what's in your opponent's deck regardless. I mean, yeah, you get to... Not just that, but I mean, I guess you get information what they're going to top deck, which is a little bit of information. I guess it's good on a dry pass. It's good in a dry pass round 2 to get a bit of information, I guess. It's okay on a dry pass. You get a little bit of information. It's okay. It's a 4 provision card. But again, Novigrad needs more than just okay bronzes. We need like Skellige bronze. This is not a Skellige bronze. This is just like another okay situational 4 provision card that sometimes is cute, but other times is kind of meh. I don't know. Play it on a dry pass like Infiltrator? Yeah, sure. But that Novigrad already has enough of those. You want to fill up your deck with Infiltrators and Arbalists and this card. I don't know. It seems like an okay card, but it doesn't seem like what Novigrad needs right now. I think. I don't know what you're doing with this card in Syndicate. I don't know what this card is doing in Syndicate. In Syndicate, this is... I have no idea what this card is doing in Syndicate. Not sure what you're going to use this card for in Syndicate, but in Novigrad, kind of seems... Meh. Got to play something on the dry pass? Yeah, I know, but you got Infiltrators for that already. You got Arbalest and stuff already for that dry pass. But sure, you could use this on the dry pass as well, but the problem is it's a bit clunky. You can't fill up your deck with Infiltrators in this card, too. But yeah, I think that's going to be it for the review section then.